So, first speaking, we'll have Ann Peters. So she's lived in Yellowknife for over 30 years, and she's currently a consultant with Dillon Consulting. She's a planner there with a degrees in fine arts, architecture, and planning. She has done project planning, facility planning, capital planning, and strategic planning on work throughout the Northwest Territories and Nunavut. She's a long-standing interest in public spaces and how they change over time and what they mean to people. And now we'll listen to her speak and have her presentation.
Challenging. Okay, there we go. So who's going to get it rolling? When do we start?
It's already started.
It started now.
You lost 10 seconds.
It says it now. Okay, so here's quick 10 thoughts about planning for tiny houses. I wanted to start by kind of declaring my personal bias. My experience with tiny spaces dates back to when I was a student living in Quebec City, where I rented a very tiny and very cheap cute little apartment just behind the Chateau Frontenac. Because it was so small, I was outdoors a lot, going to cafes, walking around. I'm still not good, okay. And I'd expand my sense of chez moi. I love living there, but I don't live in a tiny house now. But so who does live in tiny houses? I think maybe there's some preconceptions about who the people are, but I also think that people from many walks of life are motivated to live in tiny places, either because of a desire to do it yourself or to live with less belongings because of the low cost, or to reduce the environmental footprint. So speaking of footprint, tiny houses can certainly take up less space on a standard city lot, but maybe not less of a footprint than a larger apartment building. And also looking at the bigger picture, on the other hand, there's other uses for downtown land that maybe aren't so great either. An awful lot of land downtown is used for parking lots. So, acquiring land for tiny houses is really problematic in most cities. And that's because the idea of the game is to buy and rent and sell, and the winner is the person who makes the most profit. So people do find ways to make it work. Backyard laneway houses, for example, or high-priced condominiums. There is another game, though, like a non-market housing game, but there have to be people willing to play that game. How we share the costs in a municipal setting, it can also impact the economics of tiny houses. Property taxes and user fees collected to maintain urban infrastructure are not assigned in proportion to use. They're based on the highest common denominator. So level of service is typically prescribed by standards that are founded on a bigger is better principle, and tiny is inherently disadvantaged. So towns and cities are a process where the streets are the warp and the buildings are the woof. And there are many patterns and prints in a city. So the grid pattern, like our downtown area, for example, has been pretty adaptable to small and large, short and tall, and a different mix of uses. Tiny houses might find it a bit more difficult to get accepted in the more loosely patterned suburbs. So some tiny house promoters talk about the impact of tiny houses on community. They say that people living in tiny houses are more likely to frequent local businesses and restaurants and just to be out and about. So maybe embracing tiny houses should expand, and we should start also thinking about tiny stores, tiny restaurants, and tiny streets, and maybe help shift us away from the drive everywhere landscape. A bit utopian, but hey. So as Chris was saying, what goes round comes round. We used to have one-room cabins. Another common pattern in Yellowknife, and probably elsewhere, was trailers that get added onto over time. And also moved onto apartment blocks. It's all been done before. But what makes it work? So I'm going to say possibly when it's a lifestyle choice, when individuals are able to construct with few resources and can add on over time, and when they're located in a context that a sense of home can expand into. So planning involves understanding what conditions lead to different outcomes. Conditions in this place at this time, I think, are leading tiny houses to places on the edge of town where they won't upset the apple cart. I think there's some changes that could take place that would create some better conditions for the kinds of tiny houses that would create more social benefits. Maybe some non-market land available in central locations, more commuters choosing to use public transit or active transportation, more public discourse about what makes a good place to live, maybe some examples of great design. So to end, I guess I want to ask, is tiny housing just another exotic idea from a warm place that won't really work in the subarctic? I don't think that outdoor temperature is the defining feature of a good place for tiny houses, but I do think that the social and economic climates in subarctic communities are a big advantage. Do I have to end there?